did you exactly get together? I know that I think you met while, Michael, you were at Centro. But what were the interesting details behind the way you met?
Well, I had been offered Jump, and there was an employee that I had offered a share of the restaurant to. And about 3 months before we were to open, he said, I don't want to do it. And I wasn't keen on doing it on my own. And I said, well, how am I going to turn this into, make it even better than if I had gone into him? So I said, well, let me think of who the ideal candidate would be. And at that time, you know, Centro was the hottest restaurant Canada. And Michael Bonacini was the hottest chef. And so I went to Michael and did the old, I'm going to make you a deal you can't refuse.
You poached him, in other words.
Yeah, I mean, I think that it was a great opportunity for two young guys to get into business without having to put a lot of money down. And you know, when you're young, that's like a dream come true, and it sort of gets you going so that you could then generate cash flow to do other things. But I do want to say that Michael is the best partner I could ever have, and I'm very lucky.
Well, right back at you, Peter.
So, Michael, from your position, I mean, you were a chef. Did you really, were you at that point in your life where you were ready for that change, or was it something that you hadn't really thought about?
No, I definitely thought about it, and I definitely knew that deep down I wanted to be more than just an executive chef at a restaurant, that I wanted to own a restaurant, be part of something. Even back in my days in London, England, I had attempted and gone to a bank to try and raise money, and it was very, very challenging. And I think in London, England, at the time I was there, it was almost impossible. So this was a great opportunity. I was poached and basted in butter, I guess. it seemed like a perfect deal. I'd known Peter from time to time through his fundraising events. And in fact, a few years prior to Peter approaching me to join him to open up Jump, Peter had stolen away my executive sous chef from the Windsor Arms. So I thought it was a pretty ballsy move to... you remember that, Peter?
Yeah.
You're not going to let him forget it.
No, I won't. That's right. In fact, Peter called me up to his office one day, and whilst I was at the Windsor Arms, tried to see if we could do something together. I felt at that time I had unfinished business at the hotel that I wanted to get done, and I stuck it out at the Windsor Arms Hotel. George Minden, the owner, did sell the hotel, and that was the opportunity for me to move,
right.
And I joined forces with Franco at the time. So for me, it was a great opportunity. It was in the early 90s, it was in the recession, so it does make you scratch your head and think twice about it. The fact that this was a new location, downtown, there was no other such restaurants in that neighborhood. It seemed like a big move. Anyway, we made it happen. Yeah,
so
no regrets.
Define the relationship for me, for everybody. Obviously, when I look at your partnership, it would follow that, you know, Peter, you have the business acumen, you know, the location, the real estate. You're good at finding those locations, and it would make sense that you're the foodie, so you're going to be handling all of the food requirements and the menus and the development. That's maybe a facile kind of a split, but is that how it is, or do you kind of cross in certain areas? Does Peter leave you alone on the food, and you leave Peter alone, or do you mix and match, and how does it work?
That's pretty much how it does work. Peter is definitely the visionary of the company. He is the big thinker. He looks from above and decides which direction the company should be going, and 9 times out of 10 I will agree. So it makes it easy. I definitely take care of more the food side of things, even though I do hand a lot of it off now to our other chefs, as I've mentioned, Anthony and Jamie and Marcus, which is terrific. I do get involved in the design, the build, the construction. I do my share of the sort of PR and marketing end of things. I do get involved in the interviewing and hiring of the chefs. I look at the direction of the menus and really just keep things on a day-to-day basis moving forward. I think the relationship we have has been one that where one and one equals six. It's a phrase that we coined many years ago, and it was the power of two coming together. It could be an enormous, immense energy as we wanted to grow and build the organization, and it's been fantastic. Yes, there's the odd time where we may disagree with something, and we'll each go our separate ways for a while and come back to it, and nine times out of ten, we'll reach a...
Eventually, he'll come around to see my point of view.
But, you know, I will say that if there is something that I am vehemently opposed to, Peter will often say, fine, we won't do that, and vice versa. And I think that sort of understanding and working relationship has bolstered it, has made it stronger, and has made it work. You know, it is such a multifaceted, many pieces, many moving parts to the pieces of this business. You can't be an expert at it all. So
sure.
For me to take care of what I take care of and really enjoy it and get my head stuck into it and love it, and for Peter to do exactly the same, it's a partnership that's been heaven blessed, that's for sure.
When you started in the 80s, food was a lot different in terms of how it was viewed, in terms of how people looked at it from a cultural point of view. And today, food is in your face. It's everywhere, you know, the restaurant network, everybody, the food network, everybody's talking about food all the time, the hot new chefs. You guys also have a lot of different restaurants in your group. So it must be really difficult and challenging to balance all those different needs of all those different restaurants. Does the food that you prepare in one location, how do you make it different from the other locations? I mean, obviously the chain is a little bit different, you know, the cafes, they're all the same, but there's Canoe and there's Jump and there's Biff's. How do you make all of those types of menus fit within your company and, you know, attract different people perhaps?
Well, I think each of our restaurants, we view them as a very unique concept. Even the cafe grills, which for a general term would be described as a multi-unit concept, mm-hmm. we are definitely looking at how we regionalize the menus. The one, the cafe grill up in Collingwood mm-hmm. would feature whitefish from Lake Huron. It would have apples from the local orchards in Collingwood. We'd have some of the local wine grown up in on the hills of Collingwood on the wine list. So we're really creating a regional menu around that cafe grill. There's always going to be some of the core items on the menu that will be replicated at the cafe grills throughout. But by regionalizing it, it really helps identify culinary roots. Mm-hmm. It reinforces the need to use local. It allows us to create the stories behind the food, connect with the people.
Sure.
And if we are able to hire a local talent, they've come along with great connections to growers, producers, purveyors, and they feel so much more a part of that restaurant. They,
right.
they feel great ownership to it. With the single concepts, we create a vision for the restaurant, and we want to stick to that vision. So that vision, we'll talk a bit about the food, what the food ideas are, what should be on the menu, what shouldn't be on the menu. Canoe, when we opened Canoe, we had done the deal. We sat on table six, which is right in the corner overlooking the lake one morning. It was a beautiful morning, and we were there thinking, geez, what is the concept? And it was a beautiful day. The sun was coming up, sailboats out on the lake, and we said, Christ, we should do something that represents Canada, that is Canadian, that we're all proud of. It's the kind of place that the PM would want to bring a dignitary from overseas to, or that I'd want to show my parents when they came over. Mm-hmm. And we spearheaded Canadian cultural cuisine, and that's been the rock, the cornerstone of that cuisine at that particular restaurant. Jump was much more modern American cooking. It would bring in a little Italian influence. It would be great North American classics. Mm-hmm. but it was a big enough canvas that it could reach out to cultural cuisine. And that, I think, is very, very important when you're trying to identify what the food genre is of a particular restaurant. Mm-hmm. And it's some of the heady stuff that can be challenging when you're trying to communicate that to the chef, to the sous chefs, to the kitchen team. And everyone needs to get it. Everyone needs to buy in on it for the penny to drop, for them to say, yes, I get it. I know what will work, what we should be doing, what we shouldn't be doing. Because it allows us then to have that great solid foundation to the culinary scene of that restaurant.
So you mentioned Canadian cuisine, mm-hmm. and Canoe was ahead of its time in terms of promoting that Canadian cuisine, which today, the local, it's all very big,
yes.
and in your face. Do you think there is a Canadian cuisine, and do you think we're where we should be in terms of promoting that Canadian cuisine? When I look at lists that we get, you know, at the magazine and everywhere else, you know, the best restaurants in the world, and you look at the San Pellegrino list of 100 restaurants, we're very challenged to get one or two restaurants in Canada on that list, whereas other countries are all over that list. Why do you think that is? And is there really a Canadian cuisine? Do we really have that?
I do think that we are well on our way to carving out what will be seen as regional Canadian cuisine, whether it's East Coast, West Coast, whether it's from Ontario, whether it's the mountain cuisine of the Rockies of Alberta, whether it's from the prairies. We are very much well on our way. When I left London, England, I was at the Dorchester, and heaven knows the English cuisine was nothing to rave about. The old saying, to eat well in England, have breakfast three times a day, was real. But Anton Mosiman took on the charge of wanting to define what great British cuisine about. And today, it is one of the world leaders in culinary cuisine, I would say. And I think Canada has in the same sort of groove. We're in that same road. And it's relentless, the amount of new innovative growers, producers, purveyors, how everyone is latching on to foraged foods, locally harvested, sustainable, digging back into recipes from their heritage, their families, as they were immigrants coming over, cooking dishes that were the foundation of their background. I remember when I came to Canada in 1985, Sarah Waxman had just launched a cookbook called Backroads and Country Cooking. And she delivered one to my office. And inside the book was an invitation to launch the book on an airplane flight. So we trundled off to the airport one particular day, and we all got on board, the invitees. And we flew up through Lake Nipissing and had Lake Nipissing caviar. We flew over Guelph and had wonderful veal, and over Niagara Peninsula and had delicious peaches. I sat next door to Dominic Zapparini, who helped prepare the dishes. And it really was my first tour of what was Canadian cuisine. So I think it was back there in those days, mm-hmm. not necessarily on the tables of restaurants, but it was out there, and it's for us to continue to discover and chisel out and forge and make special, because we should be very proud of what we have here.
So how long do you think that journey is going to take before we get those restaurants, those Canadian restaurants, on those world-recognized lists?
Rosanna, if I could tell you that, I'd be in Acapulco sitting on the beach. Look, I think we will never know when we reach that 100%. But what I can say is I think we have an incredible deep fabric to the culinary scene in a city like Toronto. And it is vibrant, it is inspirational, it is great to be a part of it. I think in North America we have this wonderful open attitude to new and exciting and innovative ways to cook and present and experience food and beverage. And that's our biggest strength, and we've got to embrace that and run with it. And we will get there. We will be seen as not taking the back seat when it comes to great restaurants in New York and San Francisco and LA, because I know that we can taste it. Yeah, and that's the table that I want to be at, for sure.
Peter, did you want to add anything to that?
I'm just very excited. I think food is holy. And there's something spiritual about food, and I think more and more people are appreciating that. And so this movement is inevitable. I think as people look at the quality of their lives, it's very exciting, and it's very exciting to be in the industry at this particular time.